praise to your holy name. We dedicate this time to you now.
Faithful love has always been there for me. The greatest love that I have ever known. What can I give to you for all you've given to me? You gave it all, and you are all I need. You are my King, you are my God, the praises I bring, they come from my heart.
Here we go!
This is for you, Lord, all you've done for me, I wanted to show you how much you need, my God, my God. The praises I bring, they come from my heart. This is for you, for all you've done for me. I wanted to show you how much you mean, my God. My God.
See it again.
Wooster Church, how's everybody doing this morning? If you all turn around and look up here at the tech booth, you can wave to me and say hi. Hi, everybody. I'm up here this morning to give you a little bit idea what goes on behind the scenes. As you can see, there's lots of fancy, expensive equipment up here, and this is what makes so much of what you see down there happen. We've got the light boards, and we've got the words that go up on the screen with all the video. We've got the mastermind behind the mixer, Kevin right here. Just give you an idea of what goes on up here each and every Sunday. Want to let you know a few things that are going on while I'm up here. First off, tonight, teens, we have a skating party. We're going to meet over at the Alice Noble Ice Arena at 6:30 p.m. Then we'll come back over here about 8:30, have some food and fun and fellowship and all that. Also, we are in need of Easter candy. We do a huge outreach Easter egg hunt here every year. It's on April 11th. And Miss Cindy is in need of candy, lots of candy. I think we fill 7,000 Easter eggs. So if you can bring that into the foyer, there's a bin out there to put it in. If you need details, you can see Miss Cindy or the foyer. There are details on the table there. Also, if you missed Ladies' Day yesterday, there are some leftover items out in the foyer today. You can check that out, find out what you missed, and maybe even get some stuff for yourself. And also, the Women's Christian Prayer Network. You need to get your reservations in today. You can see the bulletin insert for details there, or you could check with Deb Heller if you need more information. One other thing while I'm up here, Mr. Kevin Wright, would you come over here on the camera with me? I pulled a fast one today, people. We are doing this because each and every year, as a church, we honor one of our local heroes for all that they've done, for everything that they do here within our local church and for the kingdom. And this year, we are honoring Kevin Wright. Kevin, for all you do, so many people don't have a clue how much you do because you're often up here in the booth or behind the scenes, whether it's Sunday mornings or at Heart Check or doing videos for whatever. You do so much. And we just want to say today, thank you. We love you. Here's just a small token of our appreciation. We couldn't do enough to really show you how much we love you and appreciate what you do, but thank you. And let's all give him a round of applause, please. And Kevin's probably not going to do anything ever again for me because he absolutely hates doing this kind of stuff. But that's all we have today. We will see you again next week on video announcements. We're out of here.
Stand up. Let's look for somebody to greet, okay? Look around the grandstand just a moment, and then we'll go right into a baby dedication here in a moment. So I want our family to be ready to join Dixie and I here in front. Don't get carried away here. People are going to think you're too friendly. They're never going to come back again. After you've greeted, you can have a seat. Hey, let me just add a couple things as we're ready to move into our dedication. One of the things is, you know, how many of you know that we have tons of kids, children who go here? Do you know that? If you don't have children, I mean down this wing and back here, our preschool and our school age. And just remember, parents and grandparents or people in charge, that as soon as services are over, the quicker that you can get the children, you go in person and get them, the more that helps. We enjoy the Lord's presence in here. Like last Sunday when services ran long, they didn't enjoy the presence of the Lord back there. They're grateful, but I mean, Sunday after Sunday, and you can't know what they do unless you're there. And what I'm saying, sometimes when services go long, feel free to get your kids, but bring them back in here. They need to be exposed to what happens in here from time to time. But whether that's Thursday night, Sunday, and then listen, just a friendly reminder. We love kids around here, but man, sometimes once we get them, we don't supervise them, and they run. Anybody been passed by a blur of a kid? You didn't know what it was? No, here's the problem. Doors are open suddenly, and I'm afraid that it's going to open, and one of the kids are going to go boom. It's happened on occasion, or people are going to be knocked down. I just want to tell you as your pastor that when I'm out there, if I see your child running, I'm going to chase them down. I'm going to ask them to stop, and I'm going to get on them, but I'm going to love them and hug them too, okay? Do you understand that? Because we've got to protect each other. Some of our seniors have been almost knocked down, so let's all work together. Don't be grumpy and grouchy. be loving, but let's do that for safety, okay? Got it? All right. Hey, another thing I want to let you know, right up front before we do our baby dedication. As you know, generally when I'm here, I do my best to greet everybody, but as I was away and reflecting, I'm going to have to change my tactics. So I'm going to start earlier, I'm going to be out there, but once we get to about this point in the service, I'm going to come up, because what's happening is I'm not engaging in the service and the worship as early as I need to, and that really affects our team work here, especially between Nate and Kathy and I and other things. So I'm going to do my best to greet early, and I'll trust if I don't get you that you'll find me, okay? But I'm not going to do that, because I need to come up and get engaged in worship and really focus so I can really sense what's going on. Okay, you with me? I'll do my best to rotate different sections from week to week, okay, because there's just no way I can get around. So I'll start early and grab people there, and I try to get around. But I just wanted to let you know why. I'm not mad at anybody. I would never neglect anybody on purpose. No matter what's happened this week, I would never turn away from you, not greet you. But, you know, sometimes in the crush of things, you miss people. But you feel free to seek me and others out. And more lay people, if you'll take up that, and leaders of this greeting business, how many of you know that is so important here? Just so important to let the love of Jesus be seen and known. So I just wanted you, so when you hear people talking, man, Pastor Nathan hasn't been around, you tell them why, okay? I'm coming back to get engaged more in the worship, so I just feel really convicted that that's something that I need to do, okay? While I was away. Very good. Well, let's move into a baby dedication, and I'll ask my wife, Dixie, to join me, please. Okay, I don't need that. Oh, she's correcting me this morning. She started early, and I just have been needing a lot of that today. Come right up here beside me. All right. All right, could I have all of you come forward? First service. That's what I need to look at. We're bringing to the Lord Elise, Hannah, Klein. So I need Aaron and Jamie and grandparents and friends and family to come. Hold that nearby. I'd appreciate it. This is my lovely wife, Dixie. Many of you don't meet her because she's behind the scenes a lot. Come stand right here in front of me and face me, if you will. Face me. All right, and then some of you gather on each side and the appropriate side, whichever that is. But let's make sure we're just kind of wrap right around here. Come over here so you can see. Get close. Friends and family. Come on. Too many over here. Not enough. John Larissa, they'll come over here. John Larissa, you don't have cooties anymore, do you? Okay, don't stand too close to me. You guys have the bugs at your house, right? I heard going around. Okay, gather right in here. All right. Here we go. Anybody else want to come up and join us while we're at it? It's a family affair. Yeah, and you feel free to go wherever you need to get good pictures. All right. Well, these are tender times, aren't they? And they become more tender when a baby comes to our house, huh? And we become grandparents and godparents or whatever. These are tender, tender times. And you know what? And I realize when we do this, this is a celebration. But I also remember, think about this. I think when we were away, honey, we were someone who had lost a child. And baby dedications were always very painful for them as well. So this is just a tender time. But how many of you know that God works best in tender moments, doesn't he? And so we recognize today and bring little Elise to the Lord. And I'm saying that correct, right, Elise? We recognize that the Bible says that children are a gift from the Lord. And we still believe that, don't we? And I always tell you, make sure in these days in 2009 that you're getting your belief system and your theology from God's Word, because he says every life is precious and not to be messed with. It's God who gives life. He blows the breath of life and he sustains it. And he says, when it's all done, remember, I'll come and get you. I want you to be with me. But when I'm done with you and your purpose has been fulfilled, I'll come and get you. Just like he said to David. When David's purpose, remember, in his generation had been fulfilled, the Bible says David fell asleep. And so it will be for little Elise. Oh, my, what a cutie. What's that?
She's watching.
I know she is. She says, I think that guy's a grandpa. He's all right. And then she just did what many of you do on a regular basis. She yawned. Well, the good news is that Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Do you remember that song, anybody? All the children. But he doesn't do it just in a big lump form and, oh, yeah, just group Elise over there. He loves her specifically, and there's a place in his arms just like there's a place in your arms and on your lap. Jesus said, listen, the best thing you can do is to let your children come to me. The Bible says that children are a gift from the Lord. Please never forget that. I fear sometimes that we know it's true and we're so thankful and grateful, but after we get the gift, we kind of tuck it under our arm and wrap it around our heart and we run our own way and go our own way. But never forget that she's a gift from God and you're stewards of her life. She's really not yours, she's his. And when her life on this earth is done, she will return to him, to stand before him. With gifts comes stewardship, some responsibility. Stewardship responsibilities, I should say. And so as you stand before God, you must remember that you answer to him. I know we want to love our kids, and we do it in so many ways, and sometimes we spoil them, and we heap things upon them, and it's okay to a degree, but the best thing we can do to love our kids, hear me, the best thing to give them security in this age of insecurity is for you individually to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourselves, which means to love each other. You follow me? On the toughest day, you guys, maritally, remember that you need to love God and each other because that's the best thing you can do for Elise. Yes, everybody? Loving God and loving each other. And my prayer is that your home will be filled with his love and grace, and that when we pray, we'll pray God's blessing upon her, not just physically, but emotionally and spiritually, that he will guide her and guard her, that early she will come to a love relationship with God. Not a fearful religious relationship, but a love relationship where she allows Jesus to come into her life. She says, I choose you and I choose to return your love. So I ask you, Mom and Dad, before God and these witnesses, and that's why we do it publicly, will you just do your absolute best? We're not expecting perfection and he's not. But will you do your best before God to leave footprints that lead to Jesus? Will you do best to make your home a place of love, love for God and each other, to be the example that you need to, so she'll have the best opportunity early to fall in love with Jesus? If so, would you answer, we will? Family members and close friends, you've been there already many times, but will you do your best with God's help to be the most positive influence to point her towards Jesus that you could be? And if so, would you answer, we will? Yeah, some of you have a lot of practice with those running around your house already. Congregation, we still have room in our hearts for another one, don't we? Isn't it unbelievable when you look at little Elise here, how she's fearfully and wonderfully made? There's not another one like her. That's why we always have room for another, right? Will we do our best not to be grumpy in such a way that we'll make people, little kids, think bad of God because of the way we act at church? Will we be joyful and loving, if so, to influence her? Would we answer boldly, we will not be grumpy, but be loving and kind. All right, let me have this little bundle. Oh, she's a cutie, my lands. Oh. That's what I want you to go away from here today. And I hope tomorrow morning you'll wake up saying, Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. And you might sing it to her and say, that means you, baby, Elise. Put her name in all the scriptures and all the promises of God. And so, Elise, Hannah, I dedicate you to the one who created you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear Jesus, what a precious, precious gift. When we look into the face of a baby, we are in awe of you. Nothing in your creation is greater than this. You've placed your stamp of approval, your fingerprint upon her. You've made her one of a kind, no one ever to be like her. And Lord, you have a plan and a purpose for her. So we do dedicate her to you in this solemn time and this time of celebration as well. And we thank you for her, for the gift of life. And I pray your blessing upon her every day of her life, Lord. May your purposes for her be fulfilled. And may she grow to love you. And like Jesus, may she grow in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. May Mom and Dad love you and love each other with all. And may they fall more deeply in love with you and each other as the days and months turn into years. Bless her coming in and her going out, Lord. And may you protect her physically through all the cycles of growth. And emotionally, Lord, but spiritually guard her heart. And we pray again that she would early fall in love with you. As we often sing, Father God, Papa God. What a blessing. We praise God from whom all blessings flow. And we pray it all in the name of Jesus with joy. And everyone in the house said, let's congratulate them on this fine work, okay? Let's get a close-up here. Where are we going? I'm telling you what, this is a precious one right here. They all are. Look at that. Can you get a real close one on that face? Oh, my lands. And that's how you look when you fall asleep in church, but you're not near as sweet as she is. All right. Hold steady here, family and friends. I want to greet you again. And here's what will happen now. What we're trying to do, regardless of how many, we have to be aware of the time on first service especially. We're not trying to quench the Holy Spirit. We're just trying to do the best we can to get everything in because we've got instruction time. Teachers are prepared. But when we go into worship, we're just trying to block it out so we can just focus on that. So I want you to enter in now. This isn't about you. It's about Him. Amen? It's not about you getting your ears tickled today. It's about Him saying He's worthy. So we're going to praise Him. We're going to thank Him. And we're going to love Him through song today. Okay? And you can stand or you can sit. You can be in whatever position is comfortable to you. But let's all enter in. And let's just build a throne today that He can inhabit. All right? Let's do that. God bless you. Thank you for our music. Let's just thank our musicians for being here so early. All of our tech people. Thank you so much. Nate, I'll toss it to you. Just lead us. Lead us to the Lord. Oh, my land. She is a cutie.
Thinking of the good things you have done, waiting here patiently just to hear your still small voice again. Holy, righteous, faithful to the end, Savior.
One more time! that you would be mindful of us. What do you see that's worth looking our way? We are free in ways that we never should be. A sweet release from the grip of these chains. Like hinges straining from the weight, my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries, for you alone be glorified. Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, you know our hearts don't deserve your glory.
Still you show.
Still you show a love we cannot afford. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary, and nevertheless, we lay it at your feet.
See it again. Hey.
Such a tiny offering
created the heaven. Lord, it was your hand that put the stars in their place. Lord, it is your word that commands a warning, 'cause even oceans and their waves bow at your feet. They bow at your feet. And Lord, who am I compared to your glory? Oh Lord, Lord, who am I compared to your majesty? I'm your beloved, your creation, and you love me as I am. You call me chosen for your kingdom, unashamed to call me your own. I'm your beloved.
Sing, Lord, it was you.
Lord, it was you. Created the heavens. The Lord, it was your hand that put the stars in their place. Lord, it is your voice that commands the morning, 'cause even oceans and their waves bow at your feet, bow at your feet. Lord, who am I compared to your glory? Oh, Lord, who am I compared to your majesty? I'm your beloved, your creation, and you love me as I am. You call me chosen for your kingdom.
You call me chosen.
some have said that in the Gospel of John, the writer, I was thinking about that song. He was so confident of how much he was loved. I can almost hear him writing that song, can't you? It says the one who Jesus loved so dearly. Let's just sing about his friendship. Is he that? That relationship? Come on, just sing that wonderful name. Sing that wonderful name of Jesus.
What a friend I found.
These are personal, intimate songs of testimony.
Closer than a brother.
I love to hear you sing it, Jesus.
I have felt your touch more intimate than a lover.
Come on, lift up his name all over the house. Second verse. Come on, everybody. Really just lift up your voice now. We're singing to him alone. Block everything else out.
What a hope I found. Faithful and a mother. And it would break my heart if we should.
Lift them up now. Sing. Sound of our voices, just the sound of our voices, maybe a little rhythm or something. Come on, lift it up, sing.
So in love with you.
just lift it out and sing.
Jesus.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Oh, yes,
Jesus loves me.
I know He loves me. Do you know He loves me? In the middle of where you are. Father, we just want to tell you how much we love you. And it's our prayer that you love and love it when we build a throne of praise and thanksgiving worship before you. And may this be a fragrant offering and aroma that rises to you from the context of our lives. And I think, Lord, what means so much to you is that we do this right in the middle of all the stuff about us. We're so thankful that we heard Thursday night that you have us, and I read it again after Thursday in another passage, that you have us tightly. You hold us by our hand. Oh, Lord, that means to me that we allow ourselves to be led by you, and that's our prayer, that's our heart desire. We want to be led by you, and that involves surrender. So talk to us about that today, what that means, what that looks like for each one of us. We love you, Lord. We trust you. We believe your word is true. I know sometimes our reality seems to swirl in our experiences, but the truth stands, Lord, irrefutable for all time, the truth of who you are. So we look to you and your word, your character, and your nature to find strength and stability in times like these. And you still speak and call out, do not be afraid. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Believe, believe, believe. We do, Father. And as we sang Thursday night again, we believe that you are more than enough. So, Lord, I thank you for your nearness. It's in your nearness as we worship you that we are so blessed and encouraged and things fade away and we see things as they really are. We love to worship you. Not just on Sundays, but all through the week. May our lives be an offering to you. May we be sensitive and loving towards one another. May the love of Jesus truly be in this place today. You are no respecter of people, Lord, no matter where we are, where we come from. Your value placed upon each one of us is unbelievable. You died for every single one of us. You gave your son for every one of us. Every life has great worth. And may we reflect the attitude of Jesus who reflected the heart of the Father. May that be apparent among us, even in our disagreements or whatever we may have. May we value the one that you've created more than anything else. May your love be among us, Father. Help us to be sensitive to one another. Just a touch, just a kind word, and a prayer for others who may be struggling. Lord, I love it that your word tells us to cast all of our cares, and we've been reading that ourselves and saying it this way. Keep on casting all your cares upon him because he cares for you. And so, Lord, we know that's just a way of life, and we continue to do that. And no matter how many times we've come, we don't have to hesitate, but we can come boldly again and let our requests and needs be made known to you with thanksgiving. And so we do that today. What a great God you are. Unbelievable. You know about every detail of every life. And we read that psalm in Psalm 37, I believe it was, that says that we take our delight in you. But later on in the verses, it said that you take delight, that you delight in every detail of our lives. Another passage we read in Psalm 40, I believe it was, verse 17, that said something like this, that the eyes of the Lord are on us right now, and we thank you for that. You don't miss a thing. Thank you. And that means your eyes are on every circumstance, every loved one, everything represented here, no matter where we are. And we find great comfort and rest in that. We bless your name today. We honor you, Lord. And as we now continue to open our hearts to the Word of God, we do that joyfully, and we do it now by worshiping you in another way, of returning you, putting you first. And we're going to put you first no matter what happens to the stock market. Those things don't matter. You are first. You are centered in our life, Lord, be it great or small. I thank you. What we can do as your servants is we put you first and return what belongs to you. We want to do that faithfully. God bless each one who does that. May your blessing rest upon them. And as we invest in your kingdom, and that other people may know and hear about Jesus, as we find creative ways to reach out to this community to tell the great good news of Jesus and his love. May your blessing rest upon each one as we partner with you in this way. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The ushers are coming forward. Thank you, team, so very, very much. Thank you. Thank you. Let's worship the Lord by this great return. I just wanted to take a moment to commend you. By the way, we have, how many of you know we have church on Thursday nights, midweek worship we call it. Has anybody ever been to a midweek worship on Thursday night, 6:30? It's worth coming to, isn't it? And we shared many things Thursday night. We just have a great time. We invite you to come. But I want you to know, how many of you appreciated Chad Varga being here last week? Didn't he do a great job? And what I wanted to commend you about, you know, at the end of service that we received an offering just for his ministry, not for his salary. And I don't know what the final totals are. If you have a slide, you can put it up. I don't know if Pam got that to you. But last count, it was over $5,800, almost $6,000 that we gave toward that ministry to buy books and Bibles for high school students and junior high students all over the United States. Give yourselves a hand for that, would you? There it is. Inspire now. And by the way, pray with us as we think about the possibility, it's not definite, but bringing him back next fall to do high school rallies and things like that, that he does so effectively with the blessing of schools, because schools are starting to wring their hands not knowing what to do about kids and the messed up values they have. So let's partner in prayer about that, okay? How many of you know what this bottle means? We've had this bottle around here for a long time, and that means Crisis Pregnancy Center that we support, right? Another wonderful, you know, it's my prayer that as we, even in these times, as we all continue to do what God wants us to do and be faithful with his tithe, that we can do more and more than just offerings like this, but we can come alongside other things in the community as a church and more substantially support them. But here's a great idea. We're asking that over these next however long, that the information's there in your bulletin. Announcements call attention to your bulletin. Inserts there for details. But we want to fill this with dollars or change, and we bring it in. And this goes to support that wonderful ministry of Crisis Pregnancy Center. Did I say that right? Crisis Pregnancy Center. So let's take it out and let's make them bring more. We'll just keep this one. I maybe ought to pass this around again and let you handle it. I think that every time you do, I want this back, but I want it to go all around the crowd. I want everybody to touch it, and I want it to come all the way back here to Big Dave, formerly Big Dave, and I want him to be responsible for giving that to me, okay? So here's what we're going to do. I think every time you touch something, it embeds it in your mind how important it is. So I'm going to send that away. We have wonderful volunteers that have been a part of this for a long time. I'll tell you, if we talk about being for life, then we better let our feet say it as well. Amen? All right. Well, today for a little while, I'm going to talk to you, I'm going to return, and I think for this next month, a little series I'm going to do, I touched on it in the fall, or late fall, before Thanksgiving, but I want to come back to the idea of lordship. I'm really stuck there, and that's what I've been wrestling with while I'm gone, so I want to go back and grab some things as just a quick review, and then we'll forge ahead. And I'm suggesting you today that as we look at the glimpse of America, you know, we can look at all of our flaws, pluses and minuses, but here's what I believe, that we need a lordship revival, and that doesn't start with America, that starts with you and me. You hear me? We don't need our schools to change. We need God's people to change that will change the church, and if the church changes, we're going to see unbelievable things happen, even in 2009. You believe it? So we need a lordship revival, and I want to talk to you about it, because we get all mixed up. Some of you send me things from time to time, and this was a good one, as some of you have seen it, but it's a prayer. To me, it's about this lordship issue, but have any of you read that Billy Graham's Prayer for Our Nation? It was on Paul Harvey. He read it. Anybody hear it? Here's what it goes. Here's it goes. Now listen, open-minded. Please hear me. Listen. I'm not going to dodge topics in 2009. I'm not going to water anything down because of political correctness. Do you understand that? Because I'm not interested in what the culture has to say. I'm interested in our culture, but I'm interested in what God's Word has to say that interprets and defines our culture. You understand that? If we want the answers, we're going to have to look where they are. So we're not going to dodge those things. Never will. Never will. But in this Lordship issue, I just want to, you know, where are you getting your belief system? Do you read it on the internet? Do you hear it on talk shows, talk radio? Where do you get your opinions? Well, whatever they are, it's not that all that's bad, but you better make sure that it's backed up with the foundation of God's Word. You better make sure that your reality is God's truth and not just your feelings or the whim of the culture. God's Word. Listen to what Billy Graham wrote about these times. Heavenly Father, he says, this is just a recent prayer that he wrote. We come before you today to ask your forgiveness and to seek your direction and guidance. That's one of the first steps towards Lordship. Did you know that? Confession and repentance. We know your word says, woe to those who call evil good. But that is exactly what we've done. We've lost, Lord, our spiritual equilibrium and have reversed our values. We've exploited the poor and we've called it the lottery. We've rewarded laziness and called it welfare. We have killed our unborn and called it choice. We have shot abortionists and called it justifiable. We have neglected to discipline our children and called it building self-esteem. We've abused power and called it politics. We have coveted our neighbor's possessions and called it ambition. We've polluted the air in every way with profanity and pornography and called it freedom of expression. We have ridiculed the time-honored values of our forefathers and called it enlightenment. Search us, O God, and know our hearts today. Cleanse us from every sin and set us free. And the people said, Lordship is agreeing with God. Do you remember I shared a quote by Chuck Colson, one of my favorite writers about worldview issues? And he wrote something like this. He said, the greatest challenge facing the church today, the church today, the church today. I'm suggesting again, if the church gets it right, it's going to be salt and light around the world. Are you with me? Are you with me? I was reading Jim Cymbala's books again while I was gone, several of them. And he said, quit complaining about prayer not being in schools because prayer was out of churches long before it was out of schools. If my people will pray, that's the family. It doesn't start with people who aren't in the family. It starts with us. The greatest problem in the family, he writes, is the need to reassert the lordship of Christ. We have forgotten God and forgotten that He rules. We just sang about it at Christmas time. He rules the world with truth and grace. Oh, we know He does, but we don't live like He does. And it brings a problem. We've forgotten that this God is the source of all things. And so we create rules as we go, like kids on a playground and where the bullies rise. We live on the fly. And our world begins to revolve in chaos. I read again Matthew 7, just the first verses of starting with 21, not all people who sound religious are really godly. Does anybody know that there's a difference between being religious and godly? Did you know that? And that has everything to do with lordship. Who's in control? They may refer to me as Lord. Remember in the past, they say to me, Lord, Lord. But they still won't enter the kingdom of heaven. The decisive issue is whether they obey my Father, because on judgment day, many will tell me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and performed many miracles in your name. And that's okay. I'm paraphrasing. But now I read again, but I will reply, I never knew you. Go away. The things you did were unauthorized. Sober words to us. We have to understand lordship. Lordship. The only way we can do that is learn to come into a relationship with Him. And then, as that one who came to Jesus in Matthew 8, verses 2 and 3, and I won't read it, but he said, basically, Jesus, you can do anything you want to. If you want to, you can make me clean. And Jesus said, I want to be healed. God is sovereign. We can test Him, and we can prove Him, and we can trust Him in all of life. Sovereign, that one who possesses and exercises supreme authority over all. The acknowledged leader, the controlling influence, if you will. Lordship. Lordship. That passionate conviction that it's not about our circumstances, but it's about the God of His Word, who He reveals that He is, and who the writers say that He is, inspired by the Holy Spirit, that we build our life based upon what He says about Himself. So many times we discount God's leadership and His sovereign lordship because we make Him to be who we think He is because of circumstances that we don't understand. Well, if this is the case, then God must not be. But we got to start with Him. If we're going to ever get life defined correctly, we're going to have to start with God. That's why we get so messed up. We try to defy God by everything we see. He's not in the stuff He made. He made it. He's Lord of all. Lordship. He made everything that is. He owns it all. As we said this morning, even our precious children, we're stewards of anything and everything, every gift that He's given us. I've read some quotes. C.S. Lewis writing, he said, in God we come up against someone which in every respect is immeasurably superior to ourselves. Unless we know God as that, what? Superior, sovereign, Lord of all, he says, unless we know God in that light and therefore know ourselves as nothing in comparison, we do not really know God. He's not saying we're nothing because our somethingness is what it is because of God being in us, you know, but we can't have the right view of ourselves until we have the right view of God. That's why our world is so out of warp here. E. Stanley Jones, I'll just paraphrase, he said, I saw in a moment of revelation in a flash that all the man-made kingdoms of the world are shakable. Look at me, do you understand that? What you build in your life on, every kingdom of man is shakable. I don't care if it's communism or capitalism. It matters not. It is shakable. No matter what. Fill it in, the things people are pursuing. And so I ask you this issue of lordship. What are you building your life on? Who are you building your life on? Where are your expectations coming from? In Matthew 4, 17b, we're instructed by God's word, the words of Jesus, change your hearts and lives because the kingdom of heaven is near. He's near. And then we're instructed in this kingdom view. He says, do it this way. In Matthew 6, 31 through 3, don't worry about having enough. You can dot it, whatever, but having enough food or drink or clothing. In 2009, we can apply it. Don't worry about those things. Why be like pagans who are so deeply concerned about these things? Your Heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Say all. Some of you aren't believing it. Look at me. The Heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Say all. And His eyes are on you, it says again in Psalm 40, right? The first part of that verse, by the way, look it up. Psalm 40, 17 says, I am poor and needy, but His eyes are on me right now. Does that bring you any comfort, any security? I'm telling you, it does me. Let me read on. Your Heavenly Father already knows all your needs, and He will give you all you need from day to day if you live for Him and make the kingdom of God your primary concern. What? The kingdom of God, his agenda, where he rules and reigns. Is it any wonder why we're such a mess? Because we're trying to make God the God and Lord of our misery and our messes instead of our mountaintops. We want to come to him and, oh, we think he's sovereign all of our misery and mess, in the sense when something's a mess, it's God's fault, right? But when it turns the other way and we've enjoyed times of prosperity and blessing, we start taking credit for those things. He's Lord of all. Lord of all. William Booth, who wrote, God, I realized, had to have all of me that there was. God, have to have all of me that there was. Lordship, a radical surrender to him. Now, I want to read a lengthy passage, and then I'll make some comments on this. And I just wonder where you're at today in this topic. And I think that these scriptures that I'm going to read now, starting in Matthew 25, I think some of this will help you sort it out, not just in the moments today, but as you take the scripture and as you struggle with it, you take it in your own private time with the Lord, you read it and study it and say, Lord, speak to me. If there's anything, Lord, speak to me, speak to me, speak to me. I say over and over, one of my favorite verses is in James 1:17, where it says that God is another way of saying is sovereign, that he's the source, he's the giver of every good and perfect gift. You understand that? And I say it again, that we're stewards of everything, and he expects us to bring a return. Let me read in verse 14, read a few verses. Again, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a trip. He called together his servants and gave them money to invest for him. Gave him his money to invest for him. Did you see that while he was gone? He gave 5 bags of gold to one, 2 bags of gold to another, and 1 bag of gold to the last, dividing it in proportion to their abilities, and then he left on his trip. Some of us might as well get offended right there because he didn't give them all equal amounts. God's not fair. Come on, let's say it. God's not fair. Isn't that true? That verse ought to bug some of you. I want to read again the end of it. Dividing it in proportion to their abilities. Now, as I read this scripture, I want you to go back and know this. This is not speaking of God's value of an individual. I go back to that quote I always use. God is saying today, listen, you have equal value in my kingdom, but you have a different function. Do you hear me? Don't ever mess up function and value. And don't ever rate and look at your ability as compared to someone else's. That's a pitfall. Read on. The servant who received the 5 bags of gold began immediately to invest money and soon doubled it. The servant with 2 bags of gold also went right to work and doubled the money. But the servant who received the 1 bag of gold dug a hole in the ground and hid the master's money for safekeeping. Oh, that sounds so spiritual, doesn't it? Doesn't that sound good? It's holy. I'm going to set it aside. After a long time, their master returned from his trip and called them, all 3 of them, to give an account of how they had used his money. Say, his money. It's not lordship when we think all the stuff is ours. It's his. The servant to whom he had entrusted the 5 bags of gold said, sir, you gave me 5 bags of gold to invest, and I've doubled the amount. The master was full of praise. Well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. Next came the servant who had received the 2 bags of gold with the report, sir, you gave me 2 bags of gold to invest, and I have doubled the amount. The master said, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling the small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's have another celebration. Do you think he celebrated more over the 2-bagger that became a 4-bagger or more over the 5? I think he celebrated just as much, don't you? When God celebrates a victory, I mean, that's all what it's about. You understand? It's not a celebration. Well, it wasn't as good as Wade's or Diane's. No, God says, when I throw a party, I know how to do it. Let's celebrate. Then the servant with 1 big bag of gold came and said, sir, I know you're a hard man, harvesting crops you didn't plant and gathering crops you didn't cultivate. I was afraid I would lose your money, so I hid it, and here it is. Again, doesn't that sound so spiritual? Oh, my. Squeaky clean, just like you gave it to me, untainted. I didn't defile it. But the master replied, you wicked and lazy servant. You think I'm a hard man, do you? Harvesting crops I didn't plant, gathering crops I didn't cultivate. Well, you should at least have put my money into the bank so that I could have drawn some interest. How dare God talk that way to him, the master talked to him about that money. The master was talking to his servant about the master's money. Do you see it? You see, that's where a lot of us get offended. This isn't about money, this message. It's we get upset when God starts talking to us about our stuff and he tells us that it's not ours, it's his, and we get an attitude because we're sure that it's really ours. Oh, you gave it to me. And he's just saying to us, what are you doing with what I've given you? Are you with me? Nod ahead vigorously. Up in the grandstand, are we connected? Or do I need to come up there and stand? To those who use well what they are given, even more will be given, and they will have an abundance. From those who are unfaithful, even what little they have will be taken away. Now throw this useless servant out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And I say it again, if the first verse doesn't bug you, that passage I read, then it should bug you again, because God took away from the one who had the most, the least, and gave it to the one who had the most, who was the most productive and was going to be the most responsible to do the most good, not just for himself, but for others. Are you with me? Oh, but God's way isn't the American way. Think about that one. All right, here's what I want to glean, and I want to ask you, and I got to bring it home. I need God's help landing this plane, too, let me tell you. I could bring a lot of truths out of this passage, but God has entrusted all of his blessing to us. Remember, equal value to us, but not equal responsibility. Not equal function. God has given all of us an opportunity. Listen to me, listen to me. Some of you are so focused on what opportunity you have not had that you've missed the opportunity that you have had and you do have. Do you understand? And because of that, you're living so much in the past or even on the future, but God wants you to live right now. Remember the ING mode? Right now. Not based upon what you could have done, but right now. Oh God, I'm yours, and I'm seeking for you right here, right now where I am. At 53, Lord, that's what I am. You've given me an equal growth opportunity, and I don't want to miss it. God gave gifts, and they were not equally distributed. He gave, you know what, doesn't that make sense? If God knows it so well, wait, why would he give me something that would be too much for me to bear? He's going to give me something that he knows that I can handle, right? God is being fair. God's not fair. It's just like, I want that echo. Oh, yes, he is. Oh, yes, he is. Oh, yes, he is. God's not underrating you. He knows what's best. God's people have responded differently to the things God has given them. But here's the fact that God will hold all of us accountable. Not for what we don't have, but what we do. I want to say it again. We spend so much time focusing on what we do not have as opposed to what we do. We are not responsible for what we do not have. We are responsible for what he has placed in our hands. What are you doing with it? Because I'm telling you, he is going to require increase. And here's what I want to know about whatever it is, the thing or things God's given you. I want to know, basically, what's your worldview? Do you view those things today as a blessing or as a burden? I think the one beggar thought of it as a burden, don't you? The Word of God says that to whom much is given, much is required. God is going to require more than what he gave you. He's going to say one-on-one accountability on that day. He's going to look you in the eye and say, what have you done with what I have given you? What have you done with what I have given you? And he wants to hear us say, I've invested it, Lord, in your kingdom that's advancing even now. You do know that God isn't retreating, right? Do you know that? They know it all over the world. Why don't we know it here in America? God is not on the retreat. He has sounded forth the trumpet call. Advance! Invest in my kingdom. I was thinking about that. You know, God giving, the master giving the one servant according to his abilities, five bags and the others one. But then I was thinking about myself, you know. I was thinking about my own children or grandchildren. Maybe this will help from frame. Who would I can't think of anybody in the world I love more. Who would I place them in the care of? Somebody that was less or more? Come on. Are you with me? God knows. And he doesn't limit it. I don't see in this story that's refined that it limits. Well, I'm just a one bagger. Some of you go, well, I'm a one bagger. I should have brought my ER out today, Joyce. I'm just a one bagger. Well, you be faithful with that one bag, and I want to tell you, you never know what God's going to do through you at a later time, but right now, he sees you, and he'll give you responsibility right now according to where you are. Aren't you glad about that? There weren't any no baggers in the story. Did you hear me? There wasn't one no bagger. And there isn't in this room today. So I'm just asking you, are the expectations of God on your life, are they a burden or a blessing? Well, I got to end. Guess what? I have more notes than time. I want to end with just a story. Is that okay? No? You want me just to end? We're going to have great instruction classes. Pastor Ron's going to do a miracle. He's going to do two lessons in one today since we scammed him last week and didn't let him teach. Good classes. It's not just the teaching, and that's good. It's the fellowship as well and just getting connected, just hanging out in God's presence. Okay. While Dixie and I were away, we had a wonderful time of rest, especially emotional rest, and I needed it. You know? Oh, some of you go, and I talk like I did Thursday, friend. Oh, pastor's a mess. Pastor's a mess. No, I'm not. That's why I got away. You ever get emotionally worn out? And if you hear other churches give me a call sometime and want me to come there, hopefully that makes us love each other more. And like I told you, if we could take this church and Wooster in this area to another warmer climate, let's do it. And when you figure out how to do it, you let me know. But Dixie and I had a great time. Great time. In many ways. One of the highlights was on our way back, we stopped in Carolina at some dear, 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 dear friends and relatives. It's sad, isn't it, how life unwinds? And like after my mother died in high school, she was such the hub of our extended family. She just really pulled it together, you know? I mean, she just made the contacts. We were always having those family gatherings, you know, that you don't look forward to until you get there and then you're glad you went. You know what I'm saying? But my cousin that I was so involved with, her family, and just loved and shared so much with, after my mother died, I mean, they moved and went into the business world and became very, very successful. And I just want to update you this because of one quote that I'm used to. I'm still dealing with this lordship thing and this about God's sovereignty. And so, having not been with them for years, they began to tell us in person about the journey, their last 10 years, and how, what a struggle. Now these are rock solid, God-loving, God's in control kind of people. But their world was rocked, and I've told you some of the story when they had a son that was exactly the age of my daughter Hillary, and 10 years ago he was diagnosed in summer, just the most wonderful kid you'd ever see, was diagnosed as soon as school was out in June with a serious brain tumor, and by the beginning of October he was dead. That rocked their world. You know, good, God-fearing people. And just went on a journey. And I could tell you about that. And you know what? It's my goal to have them here one day and just to interview them and let you tell you what God's done. I like to do that. But that wasn't it. I mean, my first cousin had some serious physical problems that she never had. You know, the first 40 years of their life, I mean, they just sailed along, like soared with wings as eagles. We like those stories, don't we? Oh, we love it. And you know, when you're in pain and don't feel good, the other stuff you're dealing with is extra heavy too, isn't it? And then another twist of that, because the two older daughters were so close to their brother who died at age 11, that was just such a sledgehammer on their faith, and they went away and just have struggled so much, and even some tragedy in their own lives. It's not a done deal, but a lot of hurt and pain. Sharp, but hurting. And then, if that wasn't enough, in this recent world that we're living in, the man who has been very successful in finance and one of those very senior executives, a godly man that had thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of shares in a company that if I said it, you'd know it and go, nobody would have thought 3 years ago that this company, they thought they were untouchable. But guess what? They went down. The senior executives were gotten rid of, and all of those shares in a moment were nothing. Millions of dollars became a pile of ashes. Hear me, I'm not making this up. I'm still talking about lordship. And he sat with tears in his eyes at the table that evening and told Dixie and I. He said, if I ever didn't know it, I want to tell you what I found 10 years into all this. If he's really going to be Lord, you cannot build your life on anything that you could ever lose. Not a son, a daughter, not a marriage, not a spouse, not a gift, not a stock portfolio, nothing, nothing, nothing. And so we come back to the simplicity of this lordship thing, and we say and sing, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly, W-H-O, wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. It doesn't say some, I said all. It doesn't say those things are bad, but they're sinking sand if we try to make lords out of any of those things. Are you hearing my heart? I want you to stand. Let's sing in conclusion before we go to our instruction. The altars are always open if there's some burden you're carrying or praying about. But let's do sing a little bit that night. Let's sing that verse, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And let's testify and say it. And I don't know where you are. You may have made him Savior, but I'm going to tell you, it's another step. It's a choice to make him Lord, and it works out through a lifetime. But he's requiring lordship. Lord, what have you given me, and what am I doing with what you give me? Is it a burden or a blessing? Let's sing again right out together. My hope is built on nothing less. Let's sing it right out, okay, as a testimony time. Here we go.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame,
but wholly lean on Jesus'
name.
Sing that verse one more time. One more time. My hope is built on nothing less. Sing it out. Then Jesus' blood and righteousness.
Jesus' blood and righteousness.
I dare not trust the sweetest frame.
I dare not trust
not anything,
the sweetest frame.
But wholly lean on Jesus.
But wholly lean on Jesus' name.
Come on now.
On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is.
Father, thank you, thank you. The greatest encouragement for me specifically has been this week the verse, that little nugget that I discovered again in Psalm 40:17, that says, I'm poor and needy, but your eyes are on me right now. Lord, I thank you for that. Unto whom much is given, it's required. Lord, whatever it is, I pray that we would all begin to assess what you've given us and what we've done and what we're doing with that, to sing, Lord, you are the center of my life. We want to fulfill your purpose for us in this generation, whatever that may be. So, Lord, may we walk in that, and may we turn from your blessings being a burden to saying, no, it's a blessing from the hand of God. And in these days, may we invest well and wisely all that you've given, not just on our behalf, but on behalf of others that you love. Lord, continue to move among us. Continue to bring people to yourself and a relationship of salvation. Take us on that into lordship and beyond, into the growth and the journey until we draw our first breath in heaven. We bless your name today, and I pray your blessing upon these people as we walk this out of the reality of this world. Give us a lordship revival, personally, corporately in this house, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Get your kids. We'll see you in instruction classes there. Take your time. I'm going to be hanging out here. If I